When we studied nervous tissue, we saw that there were nerve cells, but there also are glial cells. And these are not the actual neurons, but they're there to help support the neurons, and they're just as important. So here we're going to look at the neuroglia. These are the supportive cells. This picture specifically is looking at the central nervous system, which is your brain and spinal cord. So let's start with these epidermal cells. So these look almost like a epithelium, but they're not quite. They don't have a basement membrane. These are actually going to produce the cerebrospinal fluid, and then they help to circulate it throughout the brain and spinal cord. So the cerebrospinal fluid in the brain is actually continuous with the spinal cord, and it's circulated via these little cilia. We have microglia. So these microglia are called micro because they're small, and these are going to act as macrophages. So these are going to help as an immune function. So macrophages are typically going to consume things like waste or invaders, stuff that shouldn't be there. Astrocytes. Astro means star and cyto means cell. So these are called star cells because they literally look like stars. They've got all these projections coming off of them. These are the most diverse of the different neuroglia in the brain. So astrocytes provide a supportive network for the different nerve tissue. They form the blood-brain barrier by controlling what can and cannot come into the cerebrospinal fluid from the blood. They help to dilate those blood vessels or constrict them. They're going to help in converting glucose from the blood into lactate so that that can supply energy to the brain. They secrete growth factors. They influence signaling. They regulate the composition of fluid, as well as removing things like excess potassium or excess neurotransmitters from the cerebrospinal fluid, and they help to harden scar tissue. Brain tissue doesn't regenerate, it just becomes fibrotic, and astrocytes are going to play a role in that as well. And then the last type of cell we have here are the oligodendrocytes. And you can see these are pretty large, and these are kind of reaching out to form the myelin sheath. So in the central nervous system, the myelin sheath is formed by oligodendrocytes. Now we're going to look at the PNS. So this picture is, again, the CNS with the oligodendrocyte forming the myelin. But this picture is looking at the peripheral nervous system at that formation of myelin sheath. So this is formed using a Schwann cell. And this cell literally wraps around and around and around and around the axon. So you can see that it's going around. And so all of these lines are actually just layers of this cell wrapped around. And then in the outer layer, you can see the little neuron. And then this is covered by a connective layer called the endoneurite. And then again, we can see the node of Ranvier. The nodes are right here. Those are between the myelin. Myelin's function is to make electrical conduction along this axon fast. This is very important for nerves to function efficiently. They need to send signals very quickly. You want your muscles to respond right when you told them to respond. And so myelinated axons are going to look white and then be covered in these conductive myelin sheaths. Sometimes nerve fibers in the peripheral nervous system, remember this is outside of the brain and spinal cord, can actually regenerate if damaged. So in order to regenerate, if the damage happens somewhere along the axon, where the body and some of the neurolemma is intact, it might be able to regenerate. So here you can see the entire axon, here's the muscle fiber that it innervates, and then this would be that motor unit of my neuron and my two muscle fibers. So here you can see the damage, and the axon at the far end, it's no longer able to get nutrients or communication with the soma, and so this is going to degenerate. leaving eventually this empty tube. And some of these Schwann cells degenerate also. And the muscle, look at the muscle, it's gotten much smaller. The muscle is going to atrophy. This means it's going to get smaller. The soma of the neuron gets larger, it swells up. It's doing a lot of growing now. So it's going to be producing a lot of membrane and ATP. And so growth processes start to grow out kind of like roots on a tree from that place where it was cut. Some of them might grow through this tube. So the Schwann cells regenerate here and they make this regeneration tube. Regenerating nerves grows really, really slowly. Some of them might grow like 3 millimeters a day, which is very slow. And so here you can see that that muscle has continued to atrophy because it can't be used. Eventually, if this nerve makes it all the way down this tube, it might be able to reform that connection with the muscle and then start firing again. And once that connection is formed, the soma will shrink back down to regular size. And then you can begin actually firing that nerve to move this muscle. So this is a long process that will take a long time, depending on, you know, how long is this axis? How far does that nerve have to grow? And this regeneration possible is only possible in the peripheral nervous system. The central nervous system does not regenerate nerves. So a nerve that's damaged in the spinal cord or the brain is damaged permanently. So take a moment and reflect on the structure and function of myelin in the peripheral nervous system.